Good afternoon. Can everybody hear me? I think this is on. Yes. Just a couple of housekeeping details, and then I'll start the formal introduction. If everyone could please silence their cell phones before Clare begins her talk. And I also just wanted to alert those of you who are staying on for the film screening that there will be about a 30-minute break following Clare's presentation before we screen the James Joyce's Ulysses film, which Clare will be introducing. Again, I want to welcome you to this afternoon's program, and in fact, what I guess you could consider the center's 100th anniversary celebration of what has come to be known as Bloomsday. We hope you've been able to participate in this afternoon's activities and enjoy them, and especially to have had a chance to view the exhibition that Clare Hutton has organized for the Ransom Center, Women in the Making of Joyce's Ulysses. My name is Kathy Henderson. I'm the Associate Director for Education and Exhibitions here at the center, and I'm very, very pleased to be able to introduce today's program and Clare Hutton in particular. Dr. Hutton is Reader in English and Digital Humanities at Loughborough University. Her monograph, Serial Encounters, Ulysses and the Little Review, was published by Oxford University Press in 2019 and was just released in paperback in the US this spring. Clare's other works include The Irish Book in English, 1891 to 2000, and many, many essays on Irish writers such as William Butler Yeats, Joyce, and the Irish literary revival in general. Many of you will have enjoyed Clare Hutton's introduction to the exhibition she organized that was presented virtually on February 2nd this year. And we're very, very pleased to finally have her in person after so many setbacks caused by the COVID virus. The germ of new scholarship that Clare plans to pursue in the future is the subject of this afternoon's program, A Gaud of Amber Beads, Ulysses, Feminism, and Biography. Please join me in giving Clare a very warm welcome.
Thank you for inviting me to curate the exhibition, which has been a great privilege to do, and for inviting me to give this Bloomsday lecture. It's been a wonderful day to celebrate the achievements of Ulysses and its sumptuous first edition. And of course, the women who are celebrated in the exhibition, who facilitated the making of the work, and I've got some photos just to remind you of who they are. These photos are a bit scratchy, but that in itself is illustrative. This is Aunt Josephine. It's the only surviving photo, to the best of my knowledge, of Joyce's Aunt Josephine with three of her kids. She had six, and that, of course, is Joyce's mother with Joyce himself. Slightly grainy photograph of Nora, but I think most of you probably know what Nora looks like. This is Margaret Anderson and Jane Heap. Finally, Harriet Shaw Weaver. That's Sylvia Beach inside her bookshop, Shakespeare and Company. So the women in Joyce's family, his mother, May Joyce, his aunt, Josephine Murray, his partner, Nora, they gave much practical, emotional, and psychological support. The women associated with the book trades did much to enable Ulysses to find its way into the world. Beach, in particular, as you know, issued the first edition of Ulysses. This is an interesting photo, which I got on Twitter. Sometimes an extremely useful source of academic information. It's extremely rare to find a photograph of all of the editions of the that were issued through Shakespeare and Company. Quite a collection. So it gives you that sense of Shakespeare and Company as a kind of cottage industry for the distribution of Ulysses in Paris in the 1920s. Anderson, Heap, Weaver, and Beach did much to support Joyce's authorship, giving editorial, psychological, practical, and material support, which, as I shall argue, shaped the work itself. In other words, had Anderson, Heap, Weaver, and Beach not been tirelessly generous, Ulysses would have been a very different book, with a very different reception. In fact, Joyce might not even have finished Ulysses, given the difficult circumstances of his life. The upheavals brought about by the First World War, his fragile health and poor eyesight, and his financial precarity. This is a story of how female material support made a material object, a very significant material support, millions of dollars in today's terms, and a very extreme and unusual kind of material object. Ulysses, after all, is a novel of notorious length, notorious candor and difficulty, which takes issue with the form of the novel itself. Well, I've already mentioned several women, but I've also omitted several. Joyce's sisters, for example, Eileen and Ava, who lived with him in Trieste when his children were young and provided quite a lot of free childcare. And the oldest of his sisters, Margaret, known as Poppy, who became a nun in New Zealand and wrote to him regularly and supportively for decades. Then there are other women associated with the book trades, the remarkable Adrian Monnier, Beach's steadfast partner, who oversaw the translation of Ulysses into French and helped to arrange things. Ludmilla Bloch-Savitsky, who translated Portrait of the Artist as a young man into French. Jenny Cerise Bradley, the literary agent who helped Joyce and his family to settle when he arrived in Paris in 1920. Weaver and Beach were not the only women to support Joyce financially. Later, Lady Gregory gave him funds when he was leaving Dublin with Nora in October 1904. And Edith Rockefeller McCormick gave Joyce a monthly stipend for about 18 months when he was living in Zurich. Ulysses, Feminism, Biography. I look at the words in my title and I'm reminded of the taciturn Stephen Dedalus, nonplussed in conversation with Haynes. I fear those big words, he said, which make us so unhappy. He was talking about debt and Irish nationalism. I'm going to talk about feminism and biography. But I do think about that correlation, feminism and biography, because it could certainly lead to unhappiness. I mean, should feminism even be interested in biography? As Judith Zinsser has observed, biography is about using the historian's evidentiary authority to validate the life, the thought, the accomplishments of a particular individual. And there's a tradition of writing big books about great male authors, a way in which scholars can bring authority to their own career. Know me by the company I keep. Biographies privilege the extraordinary person, a particular individual who in some manner did something deemed noteworthy by the conventional canons of significance. And women in this framework have traditionally suffered some form of historical neglect. Biography poses questions for a feminist approach because if you pick out one exceptional woman, you're not looking at women's experience more generally. The more feminist thing to do would be not to look at one singular woman, but to look at women's experience more generally, looking at the governing and underpinning structures which have shaped female lives in the past. So far, so complicated. And now I need to add a bit of further complication. This is my Richard Ellman Shelfie, which I will talk about in a little bit of detail. I want to say something about the field of Joycean biography as it currently stands, and to reflect critically on its current condition. The scholarship has been dominated by the vision and energy of one man, Richard Ellman. His biography of Joyce appeared in 1959 and was slightly revised for a new edition in 1982. Ellman's biography of Joyce remains in print, which is real kind of testimony to its validity and its quality. in a sense, what Finn Fordham has observed is absolutely correct. That biography has almost become part of the canon of Joyce's works. But this picture that Ellman depicts of Joyce's personality is written with the general shape and value judgments of the 1950s, and it's more than 60 years old. As Fordham writes in what is a brilliant essay about Joycean biography, we need a fresh biography of Joyce because there's been an enormous increase in highly relevant archival material. Thousands of unpublished letters have emerged, and biography serves the important purpose of popularizing an author's works. Without new work in biography, Joyce scholarship is in danger of atrophy. Of course, no one is forcing us to read Ellman. And in a library such as the Ransom Center, I can devote hours to reading the unpublished correspondence, which Ellman did not see, including letters he did not access for the volumes of Joyce's correspondence, which he edited, volumes 2 and 3, and the selected letters. So there, volumes 2 and 3 are 1966, and the selected letters, 1975, actually contains quite a lot of new material. So if you want to see everything extant in Joyce's correspondence as it currently stands, you need all 4 volumes. So Ellman's reach extends well beyond biography to the primary source material. More than half of Joyce's letters remain unpublished, and while a new team is now, only now, gradually editing a new online edition of this correspondence, the progress is inevitably slow. And the reason so much correspondence remains unpublished is because Stephen Joyce, Joyce's grandson, who died last year, refused to sanction the publication of a new correspondence. So, there we are. We've dealt with the complications. I'm going to go back now to the other part of my title, The Gaud of Amber Beads. It's a secret object which Stephen stumbles on in a locked drawer, which once belonged to his mother, whose death is mentioned prominently and repeatedly in the opening chapter of Ulysses. Her secrets, old feather fans, tasseled dance cards powdered with musk, a gaud of amber beads in her locked drawer. The amber beads, now locked away, forgotten by others but remembered by Stephen, are an emblem of a happier and more autonomous and luxurious life. A life which predated the experience of having children, a life which was not so very intensely involved in the domestic sphere. A life with feather fans, tasseled dance card, pants powdered with musk. There's something very sensuous and sumptuous in these details. Joyce means us to see that Stephen recognises that his mother once had a life which was not that of domestic drudgery. Of course, it's a very adult perception to be able to see that a mother has an autonomous and previous life before being a mother, and that that former life is now somehow secret. Female experience is all too often locked away and forgotten in big biographies, and the amber beads are indicative as a metaphor, but they're also illustrative of my methodology. The intention of the talk, as of the exhibition, is to take the women associated with Ulysses and remember their significance. I'm not interested in privileging one particular woman. I'm actually interested in all of them. And the exhibition is really an exercise in what is known as group or collective biography. All of the women who are associated with the life of Joyce and the achievements of Ulysses. All of the amber beads, not just one or two. The exhibition decenters Joyce and privileges the women instead. And the aim is to rethink what we know or think we know about the women, thereby refreshing and extending Joyce's biography and posing questions about Ulysses, what it means and how it came into being. We know that Ulysses is a densely autobiographical book, which teases us into reading the text through a biographical lens. Stephen's experiences relate to Joyce's, and Stephen's mother, May Dedalus, relates to Joyce's mother, Mary Jane Joyce, known as May. Joyce is a fascinating writer in relation to repetition. Key ideas and scenes get repeated and replayed through Ulysses, and one thing he clearly doesn't want us to forget or to miss is the significance of May's death. When Stephen looks at his pupil, Sargent, in chapter 2, he remembers his mother's death and the role that she'd played in his life. When he was a child, she had saved him from being trampled underfoot. but now she's gone, scarcely having been. And as he walks on Sandymount Strand later that morning, he associates her death with that of a drowning man, screaming to me, "I could not save her," he laments. She saved him as a child, he could not save her as an adult. The emotional content is piteous, poignant, unignorable. Stephen, who refused to kneel when his mother was dying, is now haunted by the memory of her death, as we see so notably and repeatedly in chapter one. In a dream, silently, she'd come to him, her wasted body within its loose grave clothes giving off an odour of wax and rosewood, her breath bent over him with mute secret words, a faint odour of wetted ashes, her glazing eyes staring out of death to shake and bend my soul on me alone, the ghost candle to light her agony. May's correspondence, May Joyce's correspondence, has not been published, which is, I think, indicative of a lack of interest in her voice. And it reads interestingly against the work which has been done on Joyce's father, including a 500-page book, which is built on a tiny body of evidence. Right, so these are two biographies of Joyce's father. You can sort of see the type of book, the one John Wise Jackson, Peter Costello, The Voluminous Life and Genius of James Joyce's Father. It's a huge book, and then more recently, Contabine written this book, really popular bestseller, airport bestseller, Mad, Bad, and Dangerous to Know, The Fathers of Wild Joyce and Yeats. I have to say, I think it's kind of slightly crazy emphasis in that book, because to me, you know, Wilde's mother, Speranza, was a poet. I just sort of think you could write a more interesting book about the mothers of Wilde, Joyce, and Yeats. But anyway, never mind. Let's leave Contabine alone. I've swerved away from that kind of emphasis, and in a way, one of the things the exhibition is doing is to sort of look at the forgotten female figures behind the scenes, and one of them obviously is May Joyce. So one of the things we have on display is some of the correspondence from May Joyce. So this is one of the letters. It's a vivid and lengthy letter, it's 8 pages. I'm just going to give you a little bit of a flavour of it. My dearest Jim, your pappy's given me the enclosed to send to you £1.12, which will make you safe with your landlady until the end of the month. He was very pleased you wrote to him. I hope you'll do so frequently. Do not mind me. I will hear all the news about you and will understand. Your pappy has been in a curious state of mind for some time past and would not trust me with any money whatever. He's not so bad for the last few days, so I hope it may pass away. So, the father doesn't emerge too well from this, but moving on, the letter, all 8 pages, communicates the connection and trust that exist between Joyce and his mother, the material struggles that shape their lives. It gives a vivid sense of Joyce's family more generally, mentioning six children. She name checks. She goes through and name checks six of her surviving children. It's kind of fascinating the way she wants to tell, you know, her mode of news giving is to say how everyone is in the family. She really goes through and kind of talks to everyone, talks about everyone. To me, one of the most moving things in the exhibit is the family census return from 1901, which lists Joyce as the eldest of 10. George Joyce, see if I can find where he is. Yeah, number 7 there, actually dies in 1902, aged 14, from typhoid fever. And it must have been particularly difficult for Joyce's mother to lose a 14-year-old son, because 14-year-old boys are just so full of life and energy, you know, many meals a day. You know, I thought I bought 3 loaves of bread earlier. Oh, I did. They've gone. You know, that sort of moment in a life, that's what 14-year-old boys are often like. Although this is kind of a vivid document, it really doesn't tell us the whole story, because in fact there are at least 6 other pregnancies which ended in either infant death, stillbirth, or miscarriage. So it's about 1 pregnancy a year. And I think the letter which we looked at has a black border because of George's death. So more generally, the letter communicates that Joyce's mother held the enormous family together, and it suggests the high regard she had for James, her eldest son, is notably focused on practical issues, including cash to pay the landlady, advice on getting started in journalism, an undertaking to get his suit cleaned, prayers for Joyce's spiritual and temporal welfare. And the style is particularly endearing. May Joyce writes with little punctuation, describes herself as simply talking just as we would do at the fire here. Well, 5 weeks after receiving that letter, Joyce received an urgent telegram from his father calling him home. Mother dying, come home, father, it said, if the testimony of Ulysses as autobiography is to be believed. Aged 44, May Joyce died just 4 months later, and Joyce wrote about her death to Nora in one of his most remarkable and candid letters, on display in the exhibition. It's really interesting to me to see the original letter, because the hand is unusually even, and it looks and sounds like it was drafted and rewritten. Here's the key phrase, if you want to. My mother was slowly killed, I think, by my father's ill treatment, by years of trouble, by my cynical frankness of conduct. When I looked on her face as she lay in her coffin, a face grey and wasted with cancer, I understood that I was looking on the face of a victim. I cursed the system which had made her a victim. While the text of Ulysses tells us that May Dedalus died, scarcely having been, these documents, the letter and the census return, communicate a life which was full of life, of deep and visceral experience. May Joyce was a vivid presence in the life of her eldest son and was for a time the centre of his emotional world. Her unstinting belief in him was formative for his creative self-confidence. Her premature death hardened his determination to succeed and served him with a depth of emotional experience which he could immediately draw on in his writing. In the course of many moves from place to place, Joyce did not ordinarily keep personal correspondence. Somehow he kept the letter from his mother. In multiple moves from, you know, Paris to Dublin to Trieste and so on. And it's a tiny fragment of a rich and complicated life, and it points to the Joyce's mother's significance in his formation. After her death, Joyce floundered. The gap that was left in his life was filled in some measure by his eldest sister, by his aunt Josephine, and eventually by his partner, Nora Barnacle, whom he met less than a year later. And some of Josephine's correspondence, his aunt Josephine's correspondence, is on display. And again, it's unpublished. So this is a voice, Aunt Josephine's voice, which hasn't really been properly heard. And I'm going to read a little bit from this letter. So this is Aunt Josephine. This is a letter from 1917. My dear Jim, I was really delighted to see your writing again. I know that meant you were better. I've been so uneasy about you. I'm sure you'll pick up now that the warm weather is coming. We've had a terrible winter and spring, but just at present we have a lovely change. Did you read the Irish reviews of your book? There's a very good one in the Irish Times. They compare you to Rousseau. I feel sure of the financial and literary success of your work. How delighted you must be. How I would like to have a chat with you about it. You see, there's no one really I can discuss it with. Your American success is flattering. One of these days, your signature will be something to be fought for. Prescient. So that's 1917, just after Portrait of the Artist had been published. So many little things in what she says to note and admire. The directness and confidence of her voice, the sense of intimacy, the news sharing within the family, her complete confidence in her nephew's abilities. One of these days, your signature will be fought for, the mention of Rousseau. Clearly, the correspondence was a regular component in their lives. When Joyce heard that Josephine was dying in 1924, he wrote to her and acknowledged her significance. You attached to me in youth by so many acts of kindness, by so much help and sympathy, especially after my mother's death. Support of this kind gave Joyce a deep confidence. His writing career had started slowly. Dubliners, his first major work, was not published until he was 33. And through the difficult decade which followed Joyce's departure from Dublin in 1904, Josephine continued to believe in him and had stayed in touch. The pattern of female support intensifies during the war, when Joyce comes to know Harriet Shaw Weaver, and from 1918, when Ulysses begins to be published in the Little Review. So turning from Joyce's personal life to that of the professional sphere, a voice we rarely hear is that of Jane Heap. So Jane Heap was Margaret Anderson's partner and was the driving administrative and editorial presence behind the Little Review, particularly during 1918 and to 1920, the years in which Ulysses was being published. Anderson claims the credit for much of the administrative work associated with the publication of Ulysses, but actually her memoir, My 30 Years War, it's fascinating, but I think quite unreliable. I think kind of pretty self-glorifying and disingenuous by turn. It's really Heap who does the work behind the scenes, and one of the things on display, as I mentioned, is this letter from Jane Heap. It's the first surviving letter from Heap to James Joyce, and it's dated 9th of January 1920. Heap has a rather charismatic, artistic, loopy hand, as you can see, green cartridge ink. Before I read some of the letter, I just want to fill out some context. So first of all, by the time Heap came to write this letter to Joyce, Ulysses had been appearing in the Little Review for almost 2 years and had advanced as far as chapter 12, Cyclops. But Joyce knew nothing of his female editors because Ezra Pound was acting as intermediary. When Joyce in Zurich finished a typescript, he would send it to Pound in London, who would read it and send it on to New York. Joyce therefore had no sense of who Jane Heap was and could not read her signature. In correspondence with someone else, he describes this as a very friendly and complimentary letter from a Mr. Heap or Heap of the Little Review. So Heap's biography is really shadowy and quite difficult to recover. And her absence from the record stems initially, at least, from the fact that she rarely signed her name to contributions. Many of her contributions to the Little Review are completely unsigned. Others only use her italicized initials in lowercase, JH, as though to emphasize in typographical language the insignificance of her role and to conceal her gender and identity more generally. So here's a bit of a reading from some of the letter. Dear James Joyce, I feel much like a robber in starting this letter to you. There's always been such a note of ownership in Ezra Pound's attitude towards you and your work. We've held back with a little amusement from breaking in, even when there's been a necessity in us to express our pleasure and pride in printing you, or of our anger and disgust at the suppressions. So the Little Review by this stage was being suppressed for publishing Ulysses. We cannot apologize for the recent deletions. We can only suffer with you. Our entire May issue was burned by the postal office, and we were told brutally that we would be put out of business altogether if we didn't stop pulling that stuff. The installments of Ulysses are coming too slowly, whatever the cause. I'm going to skip a little. We do not know your attitude towards us, whether you have one. We feel that we're making an audience for your work. She goes on to offer money to pay for the stories, £5 for stories, £1 per page for poems, asks him for a photo and so on. It's incredibly encouraging to Joyce and obviously very, very keen to publish more of his work in the Little Review. So there's several things to draw out. The most important is the statement, we feel that we're making an audience for your work. It's a very precise judgment. Ulysses in the Little Review circulated to more than 3,000 subscribers and thus reached far more potential readers than the first Paris edition of February 1922. Of course, we don't know whether those subscribers read Ulysses in the Little Review, but there was certainly a lively discussion about Joyce's work in the regular reader-critic column which Heap edited. What both Little Review and Shakespeare and Company did for Ulysses was to create a readership for the work. Another interesting point in this letter is the question about why the installments of Ulysses are coming so slowly. No one had drawn up a schedule for the serialization of Ulysses, and no one had any idea how long Joyce was planning to work on the novel. Pound asked Joyce in November 1918 whether Ulysses was going to have 24 Odyssean books, but he didn't get a straightforward or clear answer. Normally, a writer would have a kind of plan or a schedule in mind, but Joyce was not a normal writer working in normal circumstances. After all, he'd been displaced by the war and had lost his income as a teacher. His sense of what he could do in the novel was changing as he wrote it. And one clear reason for this is to do with money. Joyce had first got to know Harriet Shaw Weaver in the closing months of 1914, the association being through The Egoist, the London journal that she edited, in which Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man had appeared. Realising Joyce's financial need, Weaver began to give Joyce small sums for things like the serial rights to Portrait from 1917. But then she realised, you know, that he really needed an income, and so she gave him the more substantial sum of £50 per quarter, doing so anonymously through a firm of solicitors in London. Weaver was reserved and private by nature and didn't wish to confuse her role as financial patron with her identity as Joyce's editor and publisher. Using the same solicitors and acting anonymously in May 1919, Weaver gave Joyce a gift of £5,000. This was invested securely in a war loan and gave a steady income of £250 per annum. Weaver had been one of thousands of small-time investors who'd responded to the British government's appeal for capital to pay the considerable costs of keeping an army on the Western Front. She wanted Joyce to have financial independence, believing that this would be the best way of giving free artistic rein to his searching, piercing spirit. So in a letter of gratitude addressed to the solicitors, Joyce tried to guess who his benefactor might be, the person who was giving all of this money, the £5,000 gift. He got it wrong, and Weaver was quite unnerved by the guessing game and revealed herself as the source of his income in a letter which is on display in the exhibit. Sorry, it's not a great photograph, but it does give you the kind of sense of what's going on here. So she just says, it was I who sent the message through Monroe Sewing Company, adding it was rather paralysing to communicate through solicitors. And Joyce suddenly realised his luck in finding Miss Weaver, editor, tireless administrator, patient listener, and quite exceptionally generous financial patron. Joyce appears to have never questioned what the war loan had actually funded. Instead, he simply buried himself in his work. Individual chapters of Ulysses would now take 4 or 5 months to complete, and there's a clear correlation between his decision to write a Ulysses of a much greater length and the arrival of this gift of a war loan. So, if we read these two letters against one another, we can see an interesting situation. On one side of the Atlantic, in the offices of the Little Review, we have Heap, not Mr. Heap, but Jane Heap, asking for more chapters and telling Joyce that the work is coming in too slowly. On the other side of the Atlantic, in the offices of The Egoist, we have Weaver encouraging Joyce, giving him large sums of money, in effect telling him to slow down and to allow the work to take as long as needs be. On both sides of the Atlantic, the editors were acutely aware that Ulysses was attracting the attention of censors. In the US, the Little Review was regularly running the risk of being suppressed. And in Britain, the Egoist had abandoned plans to produce a full serialisation of the novel because no printer was prepared to print the text. Encouraged by the financial and material support, Joyce was beginning to sense his moment. In the year following the receipt of Weaver's cash, he wrote two long and uncompromising chapters, chapter 13, Nausicaa, chapter 14, Oxen of the Sun. Chapter 13 being the one which led to legal action against the editors of the Little Review and led to the end of the serialisation. In a sense, Joyce is really only warming up. Chapter 15, Circe, which he wrote mainly in Paris, is the longest and most extreme of the chapters, 38,000 words. And what I'm really trying to suggest here is a sort of dynamic relationship between the act of composition, the notoriety the work was bringing to Joyce's authorial persona, and the available material support. So the more notorious the work is making him, the longer it becomes, the more money he has, the work kind of expands quite significantly as a result of these things going on in the background. So one of the pleasures in putting the exhibition together is in seeing material together, in seeing a dialogue between individuals and voices who were operating in very different cultural spheres, united by their support for the Ulysses cause. Weaver is a world away from Anderson and Heap. Anderson and Heap are a world away from Aunt Josephine. Together in Joyce's life, in this exhibition, they come together materially for the first time. And when you see the manuscripts, the typescripts, the pages of proofs, the accounts pages, the original journals in which the work appeared, the handwritten letters, the telegrams, one of the things that comes across is how much labor was involved in getting Ulysses into the world. And a particular star object which communicates the idea of work very well is this tiny ledger, which is from Shakespeare and Company, handwritten by Sylvia Beach in the period when she was collecting subscriptions for the first edition of Ulysses. And it serves as a potent reminder of the necessary administrative labor and organization going on behind the scenes at Shakespeare and Company. Ulysses, issued in a limited edition of 1,000 copies on February 2nd, 1922, the occasion of Joyce's 40th birthday, had sold out by June the 15th, 1922. And in no small part, this success must be attributed to Beach's considerable energy, her efficiency, and her business acumen. Beach agreed to publish Ulysses early in April 1921 and had drawn up a prospectus by mid-April. She anticipated publication in October 1921 and a book of 600 pages. In the event, the book ran to 732 pages, and publication was delayed because Joyce rewrote and added so extensively on proof. The self-imposed deadline for publication on his 40th birthday was fortuitous, as otherwise Joyce might never have finished making the proofs, by his own account, illegible with interlineations. Beach took a considerable risk in deciding to commit to Ulysses and in allowing the considerable extra expense generated by extensive rewriting at the proofing stage. The process didn't make her any great fortune because she gave Joyce a royalty of 66% on the net profits. Certainly, the publication of Ulysses made her book shop famous, as she'd predicted, but it did so because she worked tirelessly on Joyce's behalf. Beach was a meticulous record keeper, and the archive which documents the business activities of Shakespeare and Company is now being digitized at the Princeton Library. There's no doubt that that project will turn over new ways of thinking about Beach and the cultures of literary reading which her shop stimulated. Of all the women associated with the making of Ulysses, Beach is probably the most well-known, and certainly using the existing archives, the collections of correspondence, it would be possible to write a full biography of Beach, one which would have to acknowledge that Beach's memoirs, like Anderson's, are not entirely reliable. A point she herself acknowledged. The tone of Shakespeare and Company is unremittingly coy. The narrative contains gaps, and the facts are not always to be trusted. The text gives little sense of Beach's emotional life and does not acknowledge the significance of the relationship with Adrian Monnier, to whom the work is dedicated. Beach was over 70 when she finished Shakespeare and Company, and she found herself being defined by her association with Joyce and Ulysses. Defending her decision to write what she described as a de-alcoholized account, she commented, "Joyce was fond of garbled history, and so am I." Classically, biographies of individual figures are structured chronologically, moving from moments of formation through to moments of achievement, concluding with legacy. Group biographies do the same thing. Thus, in this case, one could have a chapter on Nora Barnacle, one on Joyce's mother, one on, you know, the other women in the family, one on Anderson and Heap, and so on. But there's another way of thinking about the material put together in the exhibition, a more conceptual and thematic way of thinking, which instead foregrounds what is distinctive about the experience of those who supported him. What are the underpinning structures which make for a confident life in the period under review? Access to a solid education, a supportive psychological environment in childhood, success and happiness in intimate relations, political representation, control of fertility, meaningful work that's valued, a regular and predictable flow of income. The women who facilitated Ulysses are a diverse group, several generations and nationalities, with very different kinds of cultural formations and so on. Yet it's generally true that they did not easily access the kinds of underpinning structure which make for confidence. Many things in these lives were conflicted. They didn't experience an elite education in the way that Joyce did. So Anderson, Heap, Beach and Weaver, none of them went to university. Joyce, not only did he have an elite schooling, he then went on to university to do a degree at UCD. The work that these women did was very often invisible, and more often than not, was not valued or considered significant. Income was very often stop-start. Control of fertility was vexed. Marriage, conforming to a heteronormative stereotype, was expected. Political representation was contested, and so on. In spite of all of these inhibiting factors, these women achieved something significant in their own lives and in the ways in which they supported Joyce. So in a way, what I'm moving towards thinking about is, instead of writing about each woman individually, I'm thinking of trying to do this much more conceptually, thinking about issues like cultural formation, experience of intimacy, work, money, legacy. So it's a completely different way of thinking about how to write a biography. It's still a group biography, but it doesn't move through the figures one by one. And one of the issues that I'm negotiating with in thinking about this is the issue of evidence. Well, evidence is always an issue in the writing of any history or any biography. And every Joyce scholar is familiar with the story of things being scattered, with the story of things being unpublished and illegible. We're all familiar with the story of too much evidence, or with the story of evidence which conflicts, making it difficult to know which story or voice to privilege. Then there's the opposite problem, not enough evidence. I'm deeply fascinated by the women in Joyce's family, his mother, his sisters, his aunt, and so on. But from a strictly historicist point of view, there's very little to go on. So one of the very particular features of trying to write a feminist biography is the need to read and extrapolate from tiny details and hints, becoming a kind of literary detective, looking for small clues in a sea of information. And a feminist literary history often involves this kind of reading from inference, from small scraps, from gaps and silences. One of the really striking stories in Women and the Making of Ulysses is the story of the role played by Weaver, recipient of over 400 letters from Joyce. So the editor of the first volume of Joyce's correspondence with was Stuart Gilbert. And when Stuart Gilbert was seeking to publish the first volume of Joyce's correspondence, he knew that he'd need to be in correspondence with Weaver, because she held, you know, she was Joyce's executor and she held 400 of Joyce's letters. Weaver selected, transcribed, emended, and omitted copy from Joyce's letters. She typed up the originals. She was the executor and had sole authority to approve or disapprove what unpublished Joyce material could appear in print. Neither Gilbert nor Ellman saw the originals of the letters from Joyce to Weaver, now housed in the British Library, including many letters which remain unpublished or semi-published to this day. Why did she do this? Well, Weaver didn't wish for the story of Joyce's biography to be dominated by narratives about Lucia, Joyce's daughter, who developed schizophrenia in the 1920s. Weaver was Lucia's legal guardian, so she knew the situation quite exactly. Nor did she want the world to know about how much money she personally had given Joyce. She was happy for the significance of her role to be downplayed. Literary history takes cues from such hints. It's difficult to rewrite a narrative once key strands have been put in place. Weaver was happy to remain in the shadows. She never wrote an account of her relationship with Joyce, making her a particularly easy figure to overlook or underestimate. There's also a really kind of significant kind of enigma with her personality, with Weaver more generally. You know, how can someone so demure and English and repressed have had so much to do with James Joyce? You know, it's a sort of real strong sense of cultural non-fit. And with Weaver, as with Heap, there's no memoir. So we're kind of stuck with... Anderson and Beach, we've got the memoirs, but in my view, they're both unreliable. So in a way, from a biographical point of view, you've got quite a complicated issue to sort out. You've got memoirs that are just basically not there, and then you've got memoirs that are there that are unreliable. Biography is often separated from the business of literary criticism. As Finn Fordham has noted, it's distasteful to purer conceptions of literary scholarship. It's reasonable, I think, for a reader of Ulysses to say, you know, I get it. I understand all this stuff about forgotten women from behind the scenes, but I'm not really here for all that. I'm here for Ulysses, for the words on the page, for the kind of book that Ulysses is, for its lyricism, its vivid characterization, its stylistic exuberance, and so on. A sort of words on the page type criticism. I understand that, and in many, many ways, I empathize with it. After all, there's a lot of words on the page. There's plenty of hermeneutic complication to keep us all busy. And I'd love to be able to say, yep, let's stick with it. Stick with, you know, the words on the page, the feather fans, the tassel dance cards, the gaud of amber beads. But the words have taken shape on the page and changed shape on the page because of the role played by women. Money and material support made the experiment that is Ulysses possible. Ulysses might not have been written had Joyce not secured the support of Harriet Shaw Weaver, and certainly could not have been written as it now exists without her generosity. Ulysses would not have been read and become so notorious had there been no Little Review and no trial of the editors of the Little Review. Beach's very generous instincts as publisher and genius for publicity made Ulysses a cause célèbre. There's no doubt that Ulysses would have been a very different book had Beach not allowed Joyce the free hand to make extensive revisions and additions to the text at proofing stage. Perhaps, and here I'm going to be a bit iconoclastic, Ulysses might have been a better book if Beach had been slightly less generous. To my close reading eye, there's often something very slapdash about the way Joyce revises the text, about the thousands of extra words he throws in at the last minute. There's no doubt that the text has a very, very significant changing shape in its transition from the Little Review to the Shakespeare and Company version. Joyce's aspirations become more plural, the style of the work becomes more radical, and the text becomes more explicit. And I could give another whole kind of textual lecture showing how this works. It's quite a complicated thing to do because you literally have to kind of compare different paragraphs and how they've changed, but it can be done. I'm not going to do it today. I'm just going to leave this with a kind of general point to say that in the case of Ulysses, the very fact of the words on the page is linked intimately not just to Joyce's singular genius, but to feminine material support. The words on the page are linked to the gaud of amber beads, which once belonged to May Joyce, Joyce's mother, and which stretched through to Anderson, Heap, Beach, and Weaver. Weaver, his particular and remarkable executor, who outlived him by more than 20 years and shaped the achievement of Ulysses, its reception, and its legacy in ways which we're only just beginning to appreciate. Thank you.